in touch with y'all on that. But that will be at 3:30 Sunday evening. Also, let's be in prayer for youth camp. It's in 2 more weeks, and the youth will be going to camp. So let's continue to be in prayer for that. Praise God. I know they're getting excited. And praise God, I would be too. Let's not forget, July the 23rd will be Feed My Sheep. Anybody interested in that or helping out, please see Brother Anthony or Sister Cherie back there. Praise God. I almost forgot you. Praise God. Amen. Ooh, y'all have to pray for me. Praise God. Is there any more announcements that I'm missing? Any more at all? Praise God. Let's stand to our feet, church. Let us pray. Dear Lord Heavenly Father, God, we just thank you. We love you, Father. Dear Lord Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this evening, dear Lord Father God. Just anoint and touch the man of God. Dear Lord Father God, as we come and worship you, dear Lord Father God, and hear your word tonight, dear Lord Father God, open our ears to understand. Give us godly wisdom and knowledge, dear Lord Father God, of your word. And we give you the praise and the glory in all things. And the church says, amen. Let's worship the Lord, church.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause shame's done all that's stealing. And you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life.
broken dreams and wasted years until the ties to disappear. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Who can work it out for your good? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way.
So let the truth be told. Can I really stand here unashamed, knowing that your love for me won't change? Oh God, if that's really true, then let the truth be told. I say I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, oh I'm fine, hey I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, and when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it. But being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin, you don't already know. Yeah, I know. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin, you don't already know. So let the truth be told.
We want our coffee in the lobby. We watch our worship on the screen. We got a rock star preacher who won't wake us from our dreams. We want our blessings in our pocket. We keep our missions overseas. For the hurting in our city, or would we even cross the street? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see the change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right now. Lord, start right here. Lord, start right now. I'm like the brother of the prodigal who turned his nose and puffed his chest. He didn't run off like his brother, but his soul was just as dead. What if the church on Sunday was still the church on Monday too? What if we came down from our towers and walked a mile in someone's shoes? Cause we wanna see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we wanna see change in the world out there, it's gotta start right here. It's gotta start right now. Lord, start right here. We're the people who are called by his name. If we'll surrender all our pride and turn from our ways, he will hear from heaven and forgive our sin. He will heal our land, but it starts right here. We're the people who are called by his name. If we'll surrender all our pride and turn from our ways, he will hear from heaven and forgive our sin. He will heal our land. It's gotta start right here. It's gotta start right now. Lord, start right here. Lord, start right now. It's gotta start right here. It's gotta start right now.
Praise the Lord. Go ahead and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. He's worthy. I tell you, revival was good for me. I needed it. I was set for revival. Revival means to live again. And it helped me. I needed every bit of it. I looked around. I said, it looks like about half of them that came didn't show back up. I said, they must have got revived out. Revival will change you one way or the other. It'll wake you up or put you to sleep. Glory to God. It'll let you. Christ a lot of times, because a lot of times when you bring an outside, and I've learned this in the scripture I preached just a few weeks about, talking about being dull of hearing, which means being lazy, being slothful. And the definition of it was really said stupid. And I thought, well, that's a word you don't want to use. But sometimes we get dull of hearing. We just get to where I'm just not doing that. And then another minister comes in and they hear them. And it'd be some of the same stuff you preach. Except for that foundation, man, I'll tell you what, that message changed me. It helped me. It helped me realize that even though we're all a different temple, we're on the same foundation. And that's Jesus Christ. Amen. And when you really get a hold of that, it'll help you. If they're truly on the foundation, they're truly in Christ, they're on the same foundation you are, no matter how they look. No matter if they got tattoos, no matter if they got shorts, no matter if they got slides on, it don't matter. Amen? I like that illustration because we're still looking for the temple to look like Solomon made it. And the temple's definitely different. Amen? And the latter rain's going to be better than the former. Glory to God. And I believe that. There's going to be a revival breakthrough the land. I believe it's going to start out in Prentice County. They're dinging in right now. Amen. Did y'all hear them? I was reading a little paper that someone sent me, and it's talking about a minister that had preached for like 50-something years, and a young minister ain't been preaching just a little while, came to him and said, I want you to lay your hand and all the things that you know implanted into me. And the older gentleman looked at him, the older pastor looked at him and said, son, he said, God is not going to put all of that in you at one time. You can't handle it. He said, you have to study and you have to grow at a pace. Because if you get too quick, grown, you'll get halted. And I said, boy, that was good. I paraphrased a little bit, but it was something of that nature. Youth is being dismissed. This class, glory to God, that is a vision. This will be a youth building. They keep bringing them in. We'll move down the hill until we build across the street. Amen. And I believe that. It's good to have our visitors. I know they've probably been here before, but you're welcome. Come anytime, Sunday morning. I believe the praise team will be back Sunday morning. It's better for me. Amen. I like that canned music. There ain't no mistakes, but I love our praise and worship. Amen. When they're not up here, I can tell it. Glory God. I can tell it in the atmosphere. You can feel the presence of God when they're singing. Glory to God. That was Bible. I'm stuck on it. Learn to rule your worship. Glory to God. That was a good word in due season. But I made a statement about all the time. I make a statement to people. They always say, how you doing? I say, I'm doing better than I deserve. And the Lord dealt with me. I said that one day, and I mean, it was just like it hit me. The Holy Spirit hit me, and he said, you're doing how you should be doing. You're a king's kid. When you're brought over into the kingdom of God, you're no longer who you were, but you're who you are in Christ. So it's no longer I that live, but Christ. We quote that all the time. It's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives in me. Then why do you say you're doing better than you deserve? It's not you, but Christ is in you, so you're getting everything you deserve. Amen. If you get something you don't deserve, might be that trial, might be that tribulation, but then he's letting you have that just to teach you something. So if I would title this, I don't know if the screen is screen on. I seen it earlier. I wrote it on there. He may not say it was in small writing. We are in his image. If I would title it, I'd say we are in his image, because you think about it. When you get saved, if you'd have seen me before I got saved, man, I cussed, I was drinking, I was gambling, I was doing everything I could. So then that was because I was in the image of the world. I was doing my thing. So I wasn't in the image of God. But when you get saved and born again and come over into the kingdom, you're no longer living in your image, but you are an heir and a joint heir with Christ. So what Christ got, you get. Think about that. Amen. He said, greater works than these shall you do. And we sit around and think, we can't do that. I'll tell you what I did today. I was sitting at home, and I was sitting there, and I thought, you know what, God? You give us authority over angels. Think about that for a moment. Now, that'll mess some people up. So I was sitting there, and I said, angel, the angel's just watching over me. I said, heal my back and my knees, in the name of Jesus. And see, we say, dispatch angels to be about us. It's actually biblical, and then they are dispatched around us. They have authority. They're watching over. But you have authority because you're seated, and I may not get all into this. I may have to finish it Sunday morning. So if you don't miss Sunday morning, you'll miss the rest of it. There ain't no way I can get all of it out tonight, I don't believe. You can ask John, I can paper that long with all kinds of scriptures. And I preach a long time on one scripture. But I begin to think about that. Christ is seated in heavenly places. And he said it causes us to sit in heavenly places. So it gives you an authority in Christ. Not in yourself, not in your ability. It's the Holy Ghost that lives inside you, gives you authority over the enemy. If you go back, and I'm already, this ain't even in my notes and what I'm preaching, but if you go back to the seven sons of Sceva, if I say that right, they seen how Paul and they were casting out devils, they thought they was going to do it. That's the difference in being Holy Ghost filled, being filled with the Spirit of God, and just walking up there and say, you know what, come out of him, devil. And they ran out naked and embarrassed, and that's what will happen. But when you are in Christ and Christ is in you, you become one. Now, I'm going to mess up some theology tonight, if I can say that word even right, but people always have a problem with, you know, that there is that Jesus is God and Jesus is God. I'll tell you what, it's all wrapped up in one because God's a spirit. But Jesus was there because in the beginning, go ahead to Genesis. I'm going to give it to you. Who was God talking to? Glory to God. He was talking to Jesus. Amen. We're going to get into something tonight. And God said, let us make man in our image, after the likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowls of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. You want to know why the devil don't like you? That's right. See, Adam gave it over, but Jesus took it back. And when you're in Jesus, you got authority over everything on earth. You know why the devil don't like you? He goes to and fro throughout the earth, and you have authority over him. He's more scared of you when you're in God than you're scared of him. Amen? Should be. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created him. Male and female created him them. Now, I have a problem with people that have a gender problem. I tell them they got a heart problem. Glory to God, there's male and female. There is no, I don't know what I am. In Mississippi, if you go in the wrong bathroom, you might wake up with a beeping sound. Yeah, glory to God. That didn't cost you nothing. Their grandpa's around here knocked someone out. They try to go in the bathroom with their little girl. Amen. Glory to God. Go ahead. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful. Now, when he blessed them, he made them male and female. He's now blessing you. Now, you're going to multiply. That's why it was male and female, so you can produce. That's what he's telling them. He said, bless them. And God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowls of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Right there is why the devil don't like you, because he's moving upon the earth. And listen, I ain't making this up. He gave that authority to man. Man gave it to the devil. Adam failed and turned it over. But when Jesus came, he took it back. And then when you become in Christ, you're made in the image of God, and you're made in the image of Christ because they're one and you're one. I have a problem. You know, I'm going to end up in there. It might be Sunday, but I got a scripture, but I'm going to give it to you because I may not never get there. But in 1 John 5 and 7, he said there's three that bear record: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. He said these three are one. How are they one? Same way we're one. You know how we're one? We're in unity, and we love. So when you are in, when you're love and you're in unity, you're in one. That's how they're in one. Amen. Glory to God. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and this opportunity. I pray, God, that your word go forth, penetrate the hearts of the hearer. God, may we leave. God, I said it today. I prayed today. That was my very prayer, God. Don't let it just be words, but let it be the word of God that be spoken, that'll penetrate the hearts of the hearer. God, we'll leave different. God, it'll do something to us. It'll change us, transform us. God, we'll live different. We'll walk different. We'll talk different. We'll be filled with the Spirit of God and live after the things of God, not the world. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Go ahead, Brother John. I'm going to try to get through, but I know I probably won't. And even if I do, there's more to this. I just didn't have enough room on this paper. I might transfer it over. But I'll more likely be on some of this again Sunday morning, talking about Gideon and some Rahab and some of these others. But I want to get into the depth of it. Here it is. You know, people always say, that's the Old Testament. You ain't got nothing in the New Testament. Well, here's Mark 10 and 6. But from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. There's no way around that. And I'm going to tell you something. He made them male and female. And then you get in the New Testament and find out where he says they're neither male nor female in Christ. In other words, it's the same avenue to get to Christ. You got the same avenue to get into the holies of holies and pray and get to God. Amen. Listen, I want to share this, and I really want to get into it. Psalms 139 and 14. Who are you? What are you? Where are you in life? Amen. I get into a lot of that lately. What are we really doing in the kingdom of God? Man, I thought that about you need to be teaching, and why ain't we teaching? Why ain't we all preaching? Why ain't we all preaching? I ain't going to say that other word, but we just get complacent. Brother Justin's going to do it. Sister Monica's going to do it. Everybody looks and waits for someone else to do it, and then no one does it. Amen? And we all ought to be ready to preach and to teach and to do something. I looked at that crowd through revival, not Friday night, because that was youth explosion, but just through the revival of the different people. And it was like God said, the only way to have a diversity of people is to have an adversity of teachers. Amen? Because we all teach different. We all preach different. Same foundation, same word, we just preached it. Psalms 139, 14. I praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. Man, when I was looking at that earlier, I thought, you think about that. Here it is, the psalmist is saying, I praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. That's sort of boastful, but when you think about God's creation and what God done, that's what we are. So many times people have a problem, and they have a problem with loving themselves. It ain't that, you know, it's hard to love someone else when you don't love you. And you got to learn to love you so you can love somebody else. And you got to learn who you are in God. Before Christ, there was a reason I didn't want to. There was a reason I wanted to do things I did. There was a reason I stayed high. There was a reason I stayed drunk. There was a reason I gambled all the time. I didn't like me. I didn't like me. I didn't like life. I didn't care. But then when I got saved, I became a different creature. I became a different creation. I became in the image of God. I no longer lived like that, but I began to live after what Christ did, because it was Christ living in me. I remember the very next day saying a cuss word. I knew that day something happened. I've been to church. I cried. Experienced many moves of God, but I never had a 1997. I had an encounter, because on 21st, when I went to the job, it was still hot, something wasn't going right, and I went to cussing, and immediately he said, we don't talk like that. Man, I could just, some people say, well, I ain't never heard his voice. There's a reason you ain't heard his voice. He said, my sheep know my voice. Heard his voice. Glory to God. Means you ain't saved. You ain't born again. You really got to get connected. You really got to learn to go to the altar. You really got to learn that repentance is a key and turning from that sin. And then you can have a relationship with the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then he can talk to you. Instantly I knew. As soon as I did, I was like, wow, never felt that before. Well, you weren't saved. Well, then why was he talking to me? Just because I said that cuss word don't mean that I wasn't saved. Just mean I stumbled. I mean, I had to learn. It means I got to grow. Glory to God. I didn't get to where I'm at in 1 week or 1 month or 1 year. It's been 24 years. It's been 25 years in July. So it takes time. And, you know, that's what I prayed. I said, God, I don't want the knowledge of that man from 50 years. I want the knowledge of a man been saved 25 years. I said, let me operate and function in the ability you gave me and help me learn. And don't let me learn too quick. Let me learn in your speed. Glory to God. But we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works. You know you're his work. Think about that. You're his work. That my soul knoweth right well. He said, man, I know that I'm wonderfully made, because I'm made to hold of something. Listen to what it says in 8 through 10. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. And this is going to help somebody. Not any man should boast. Now works. I want to touch on that for a minute. Works. Not the works that we do, but the works that he does. What he done on Calvary gets us in. It's our faith in Jesus Christ and what he done. That's the works. If we don't work our way in. Go ahead. For we are his workmanship. In other words, we're his creation. You'd have to go back to Psalms 139, 14. Read it again. I'm fearfully and marvelously made in the image. I am. My soul knoweth right well. Listen, he said, for workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. So you're created in Christ Jesus unto good works. They're going to follow. Proper faith will produce proper works. Won't nobody have to tell you. You know, it's like I told somebody, I was preaching on the job, really, basically, if you just want to know the truth. And I was preaching this, man. I just flat out told him that, you know, that it's the good works. You're saved under good works through Christ. And it'll produce the good works, and you won't have no choice but to do good works. You'll want to tell somebody about Christ. You'll want to lead somebody to the cross. You'll want to bless somebody. I said, listen, if God ever tells you to give me $100, the devil ain't going to tell you to bless me. That's what I told him. And if he tells me to give you $100, I know it's not the devil telling me to bless you, because I'm filled with the Spirit of God. I know who it is. It's God telling me to. Some people say, well, God ain't never told me that. Well, he knows you're too stingy to buy somebody a hamburger. Better yet, give them $10. See, I dropped it to $10. That'll help somebody. I don't want it, but you see someone in need. Glory to God. Why do you think he blessed you like he blessed you? Take care of somebody else. I don't want to just take care of me. I want to know to take care of somebody else. Glory to God. That'll mess somebody up. And he said, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Walk in what? Walk in good works. It'll come natural. You'll just do it. I'm not doing it to get saved. I know it's not going to save me. I know it's not going to get me no more up the it's just going to cause other people to get saved. If I do good works, if I produce good works, and to walk in them as Christ did, we are to be Christ-like. Amen? When was the last time you seen God, you seen Christ wearing one of the bands, what would Jesus do with a Budweiser in his hand? Amen. I drank all the beer I wanted to drink last night. I didn't drink none. Now, it'd been 25 years ago, I'd have been drunk last night. You see what I'm saying? It's God. It's no longer I that live, but Christ. And that produces good works. It'll cause you to want to live a godly life in front of somebody. Amen. It's like Brother Michael come during revival, and he got up. I listened closely to what he said, because I understand that people are watching you, but listen, if I fail and I fall and I don't serve God, it should not, because I've seen so many people come and so many people go, and if you let that kind of stuff bother you, you'll never make it. Your eyes has got to be fixed on the cross and on Calvary and what Christ done, and when you do that, you're a fix. You're a dead man walking. You're looking at the cross of Calvary and what Christ done, and it don't matter. If everyone quits, I'm going to serve Jesus. That's what you got to say. And that's what he said during that. He said, if you would have quit, I would have quit. Why? He seen my son die. He seen me bury my son, preach his funeral. He seen my grandson die. He seen me preach his funeral. He seen me live through that adversity. He seen me live through the trials, through the tribulations. And he said, if you'd have quit, I'd have quit. And see, that's not the way it's got to be. You got to say, no matter what, as for me and my family, I'm going to serve God. I prayed in my office after they died and said, God, if you take my whole family, I'm still going to serve you. I believe that might have stopped something. He said, all right, we'll keep them around for a little while. But I prayed. I prayed before God. If they're not going to serve you to the end, take them while they're in. Glory to God. I've had someone tell me I've been mad at God. For what? God did what I asked him to do. Take him while he's serving you. Take him while he's in church. I don't want him to end up in a devil's hell someday. And I know that we feel, you know, I tell people all the time, you don't lose your salvation just like that. But there is a reason that it says over there in Peter, it's better for you to have never known than for you to know and have fell away. So there is a place you can get. I pray I never get there. I pray I never know no one that gets there. Glory to God. But while my children say, take them while they're saved. Take them while they're there. I don't want them to end up in that place. I think it's hard to get there, but you can get there. Or that scripture wouldn't be there. The scripture's there for us to learn from. Glory to God. Where'd y'all get before you got the message? I told you I got to get done. The word works means not by our acts, not by our deeds, not by our doings, not by our labors, and not by our works, but by what he did. I wrote that down. I thought it was important enough to write it down. That it's not our acts, it's not our deeds, it's not our labors, it's not our doings, it's not our work, it's his work. It's what he did. That's what gets us saved. And what we have to do is pour that out on the other people. Tell them, because you know why people won't come to church? One of the number one things they tell me, man, I ain't got no clothes. Well, come on, we'll get you a robe. Put some sandals on your feet. You'd be like Jesus. Amen? There might be some people have a problem with that. I wouldn't have a problem with that. Glory to God. I got a whole closet. If they can fit in my shirts and my pants, I got all kinds of clothes they can have. That's an excuse. I tell them all the time. I tell them all the time, we'll take you to Walmart, buy you some clothes. Walmart clothes, we'll take you somewhere else. Don't let them get in there. Have a relationship. Find out about a God that loves you. What do you say, Brother Justin, all the time? Ain't nobody want to hear about that Jesus. They don't hear about that Jesus stuff. I tell you what you do when they get in a bind. I tell you what they do every time. Hey, y'all ain't got none of that Jesus money, do you? Yeah. Jesus money. I got to do this. Got to pay this. Some of that Jesus money. I'm just honest with them. We help them. We really do. We help them. But you know what I tell them? Find you a local church. You know why? You know what the local church is for? If you're a member of that local church and you're part of that local church and you fall in the hardship, that local church should help you. Local church should feed you. Full extent of all they can, as long as they're able. But if you don't have one, you know, what I tell people, I have told people that before. I think you should get it from the church you've been going to. Well, I don't go to church. Hello. And you can come to. We'll start it out today. That's good preaching. It's really good to tell people, get a part of a local body where you'll have family. You ain't just a church. You're not just a church member here. You're family here. I feel like we're from. That's why when someone leaves, it hurts pastors. They get over it quick because they say, you know what? I'm not going to quit. When Jordan died in that car wreck, bam, I'd have stopped. I said, God, I thought you had my children. But I knew him that because he does got him. Amen? Praise God. We got to get to where we trust God. And that's what we talk about sometimes, Brother Arnie. We say, amen. I'm in a transition of trying to get out of the framing, which has paid me good money for 40 years. And I'm in a transition of getting out of it, which is going to cut part of my, but glory to God, I'm good with that, because one thing God's telling me more and more, especially as the day's approaching, getting into Hebrews 10 and 25 now, not for assembling sake and selves together in the house of the Lord is the day of the man. As you see some, and over, don't quit going. I'm paraphrasing. I butchered it. But that you look at it for yourself. Amen. Especially in these last days, be about the Father's business. And man, here I am, got so many gadgets and toys I'm thinking. Amen. But it's not wrong to have stuff as long as it ain't you got. Don't take me wrong. God already knows my heart. He spoke to me one time and said, give all, and I gave it. And I didn't want to at first. I really battled with it. I use it for a testimony. I don't do it to brag, but I'm doing it because that's what Christ did. But he said, give it. And I was like, I still remember my prayer. I said, God, the devil is trying to be like you. And it was, to me at the time, I never made money like that. To me at the time, I've been saving, going to go to Hawaii. It was a big chunk of money. He said, give it. I looked at my wife and said, what'd God tell you? 10,000. I was like, devil's trying to get your money too. I wanted to back out. But I knew it was God. And I knew what he spoke to me. He said, I got to know that everything that you got belongs to me. If it's you, see if he can trust you with it. Amen. It's like this, we hang on to it, that's what it is. But when it goes like that, God multiplies a whole lot. It was then. Because it's God. It's not that lives in me. Do we really trust him? That's a hard thing when God says, give a certain amount of money. You say, well, Lord, I ain't got all of it. And then I'm like, well, I'll pay the rest of it. He's wanting to know if what you got belongs to him or does it belong to him. Glory to God. I know what you're thinking, Brother Justin. Hope he tells you to give me that boat. If he does, you'll be driving that thing Saturday. Glory to God. I mean, that's where you really got to be. Glory to God. Where'd y'all get before I got to meddling with you? Amen. We're going to 2 Corinthians. We're just going to fix these things. I'm going to throw them outside. I can't get used to them. They're the higher power. Make me see better. I just can't get used to them. 2 Corinthians 4. This earpiece messes with it. And 4. It says, in whom the God of this world, who is the God of this world? Satan. In whom the God of this world, Satan, has blinded the minds of them which believe not, a willful blindness. I'm telling you, it was a willful. Lest the light of the Christ, the message of the cross, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. If man rejects the cross, they have in fact rejected Christ. So if they reject, this is the key. We always think people's rejecting us. We have to be a mouthpiece. He said, you are an ambassador for Christ. You have to talk. You don't have no choice. It ain't that. What will I say? How many times you been eating? And man, I've done it. You've been eating, and God say, you buy their food. I won't buy their food. I don't even really know them. Bless them. There was a guy standing by me today. I didn't know him from Adam's house. They're minding my own business trying to pay for my food. Lord, threw it up there. He's like, hey, I don't do that. I said, I got you. I said, God bless you. And go, but you know, it's one of them things you got to, if you don't do it, you just won't do it. And then you leave and that's it. The old devil will try to play with that. Then he'd be like, yeah, do you really trust God? Had you? You turned it down. Amen? That's not bragging. Jesus. It ain't bragging on me. I'm telling you, before salvation, I wouldn't give them a quarter. I might have been waiting on them to pay for mine. Hey, you got this? Because why? Because without Christ, it's selfish. It's take care of me. It's what I want. It's what I want to do. It's take care of me and mine and my house. But then when you get saved, it's take care of somebody else. It's take care of you. It's take care of them. Y'all looking at me fine. Well, that's the way it is at mine. I don't think it may be different. Well, maybe there's only 3 or 4 of us saved in here, right? I preach something else. I'm at the wrong spot. I was trying to tell you how wonderful you are. Maybe we still got a lot of work. Ephesians 4, 21 through 24. Listen to what it says. And my watch may be wrong. Nah, we got plenty of time. Glory to God. Youth ain't even half done yet. If so be that you have heard him, talking about if you've heard Christ preach, and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning the former life, manner of lifestyle, the old man, which is corrupt according to the person is subject to have a continual process of corruption, which grows worse as time goes on. And renewed. Let me tell you something. I ain't never seen so many people upset over saving the life of a baby. Blows my mind. I'll go to jail for it. I don't care. And listen, if you've had an abortion in the time past, I got family members that have. That's fine. Let's go from now. Let's go when we get saved and go forward. I ain't looking at that. I ain't never seen so many people. They'd be mad at me if they want. Got people I know in this town. I do not care. If the Christians, if the children of God don't stand up for life, no one else is. I heard a woman that worked on the radio on AFR. She was a doctor that actually did it. And she said one day she was sitting there and had a 12-week-old baby there. And she said as she was doing her procedures and doing it, and she said she was sitting there and she looked at that baby after she took the life of it. And she said she felt it. This baby and my 4-year-old baby. And I thought, thank God somebody opened up her eyes. Now she's of pro-life. Now she runs around preaching it. Amen. I like what Ronald Reagan said. I seen that the other day, that clip on Facebook. Ronald Reagan said, it's amazing that the people that's for abortion are already alive. Huh? Yeah. You don't get somebody mad when they say, I'm for abortion. Say, in your case, I would have been for it. The rest of them, I'm sort of, yeah. Hey, that gets you in trouble, isn't it? I'll be careful. I'll make sure. A statement like that. Say, you going to fight me, buddy? Glory to God. Amen. You know what they tell you? This is what they tell you. You know what they tell me? If they watch Lifestyle, this is what they're going to tell me. Preachers don't get political. I think you ought to know where a Christian stands. I think everyone ought to make their voice be heard. Glory to God. If you don't stand, they're gonna do it all over again. Amen. Just because government says something's all right, don't mean it's all right. Amen. Glory to God. Where'd y'all get? I was doing good and y'all got to meddling. Somebody got off course. He says in verse 23, renewed in the spirit of your mind. Now listen, this is a continuous act. Has to do with will. The mind of the believer must be pulled from a dependence on self to a total dependence on Christ. Making the cross ever the cross of one's faith. That's it. If you do that in your salvation, do you know why we always struggle? We struggle with, man, guilt to fall on. Where's guilt come from? Sin. How is sin attached to you when you're saved? Well, if I sin. If you sin, you have an advocate with the Father. You go to 1 John 1 and 9, I believe it is, and he says, if you can just to forgive them, why don't you put it back under the blood? You know why people don't come to the altar? Someone's going to think I did something wrong. You don't think he already done seen your heart? Why don't you get rid of the guilt? I've done things since I've been saved. Ain't none of y'all. I've done things that I'm not proud of since I've been saved. But you know what? I don't walk in that shame and guilt. I put it under the blessing. God, help me to do better. I'm weak in that area. When I get around that, I'm prone to do. Lord, help me not to be so weak. And I put it back under the altar. And I got to fight it again. Amen. We ain't got no weakness. It's like somebody was earlier made a statement. I wish I could remember what they said. And see, it's so easy to judge. It's easy to take it off you and put it on somebody else. And I said, what's the difference in their sin and mine? And they looked at me like, you're a preacher. I said, yeah. But every now and then, huh? I wasn't trying to condemn myself, but I told him every now and then, I eat a little more than I'm supposed to eat. What's the difference in my sin? I said, ain't they sin? Well, that's sin in the eyes of God. I know we think murder's the big sin, but that lie is a big sin. It's all sin. You know what? We all have an advocate with the Father, which is Christ Jesus, the man. We all have to go and confess and get it under the blood. Then we're free from that. Then we're not guilty of that. Then when I don't say, someone look at me and say, man, I know you did that. You did wrong. Man, you're talking about last month. I done put that under the blood. I done prayed about that. You're dealing with that. You still eating on that. It's still you carrying that weight around. I done got it off of me. I done put it under the cross. I done put it at the cross. I done asked him to forgive me. I know he forgives me. My hope, my confidence ain't in me. It's in him, and he lives in me. And I don't walk around with that guilt. I'm going to take my watch off. That way y'all don't bother me. We may get done with it tonight. Hallelujah. Since y'all give me the liberty to take my watch off. And that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and truth. Holiness. Man, I'm telling you, when you get saved and you truly get saved and you're truly born again and you're renewed and the new man's living inside you, man, you just walk. He said, this is what the new man is supposed to be and what he can be, but only by reckoning himself deed unto the sin nature, which was done at the cross, but alive unto God through Christ, our Lord and Savior. Man, that's the key to it. When you start realizing it ain't you, but it's him, and you really walk in that, then you're getting somewhere. Listen to Colossians 15. It says, in whom we through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Same thing I'm talking about. Listen to this. At the cross, the Lord broke the power of sin and took away the guilt. You just look it up later. You can go to Romans 6:6 and look at that. But he said, he broke the power of sin and took away the guilt. So, you know, that helps me. When I hear people, they'll be like, well, if you're saved, you're going to do this. No, you know, Paul said, I do the things I want. You know, he did things he didn't want to do. And the things he wanted to do, he didn't do. Do you know what that means? That means there's sometimes we do things we shouldn't do. But, you know, I got good intentions. I'm going to tell you what. Right. I go eat. Some of y'all eat with me. And I got good intentions. I sit down there and I say, I need that 8 ounce. But I'm going to get that 12 ounce. Now I'm going to get it cooked. Now I'm just going to eat about half of it. And I'm going to take the other half home. Man, that thing gets to taste. Before I know it, I ain't got no breakfast. I'm sitting there, man, I wish I hadn't did that. It's called weakness. I told you one time, I was sitting there one day thinking, this is where we are in our struggles of being weak. I'm going into the kitchen. It's been a long time ago. I ain't eating. I told her to quit getting them things. Just quit buying them. I don't want no more of them. I love them. In my office studying, and I decided I'm going to go get me an ice cream sandwich. You can tell I like them. Man, they're chocolate wafer, vanilla ice. Man, that's what little fat preachers like. So I go in there, and I said, I'm having me one of these. And then I'm sitting there looking at the box, and I'm thinking, if I get one of these, I'm going to be walking back in here in a few minutes. I grab three of them. Go to my office. Yeah. I told her, I said, do not get no more ice cream sandwiches. I can't control myself. Man, you know why I got three, don't you? Man, that saved me two trips. And I needed to exercise. I should have got a half and went back and forth several times. Glory to God. Like Brother Arnie would have did. But I got to get three because I don't want to make a bunch of trips. So it's called a weakness. And we all have them. We act like we do. You know how we act like we don't? When somebody else has got something that you can see. Yeah. Get the beam out of your eye. For you. It's in there to help us. But we're so worried about everybody else. You got all kinds of stuff swept up in ours. We don't want to talk about ours. I'll tell you what one of mine is. My wife will tell you one of mine is. Sister Melissa and Brother Butch tell you what one of mine. They've been on trips with me. I go into a place to eat, and I'm looking at the menu. I'm wanting, man, it's a weakness. And we have, it's not my only one. I got other weaknesses. You don't know what they are? It's Nungie. Hey, glory to God. If the Lord tells me, I tell you, we all struggle with stuff. Man, sometimes I get mad. I have to bite my tongue. Who is the image? Now listen to this. God, the firstborn of every creature. Listen to this. It says, who is the image of the invisible God? The Son is the exact reproduction of the Father, a divine image. Listen. And he says, when it says of the firstborn of every creature, it says actually means Jesus is the creator of all things. And we got to believe that and know that. And you know what else you got to believe? You're in the image of God. You got to believe that when you Christ, and you got to believe what Paul said. He says, no longer it's the word of God. It's not something I'm just telling you. It's something the word says. So you are in the image of God. You are one with God. You are, he said, me and my Father are one, and you are one with us. I've got the scripture. I'll end up in it before it's over with. It may not be tonight, but I think it will. We're close. Ain't we, Brother John? Psalms 8, 4 through 8. You tell them that where they'll hang in there. I got some of them sleeping on me. I ain't pointing nobody out. Glory to God. What is man that you are mindful of him? And the son of man that you visit him? You have made him a little lower than the angels and have crowned him with glory and honor. You made him to have dominion over all, over the works of your hand, over all the works of your hand. Listen to this. You have put all things under his feet. Do you know who you're in the image of? Do you know who lives inside you? The Holy Ghost. Jesus said, me and my Father's one and you're one. What he done for him, you don't think he's doing for you? You're an heir and a joint heir with Christ. You know what that means? You're in the same seating. Now that gets people messed up. That's not being boastful. It's telling you when you really are in Christ. Amen. Walk in that. Glory to God, who has made you put all things at his feet. In their fullness, these words given here are only true. Jesus Christ. Matthew 28:18. You can look at it. Exalted to a place higher than the angels or any other being except the Father. Redeemed man. Do you know who redeemed man is? No one knows. I'm a redeemed man. I'm redeemed. Listen, I'm not a recovering alcoholic. I'm not a recovering. I'm a redeemed. There's a difference. I'm covered by. I was a recovering, I might still be doing it. But I'm redeemed. I'm covered by the blood. I'm set free from it. And you need to learn to speak that in your life. Redeemed man up to that exalted position with him. Go to Ephesians chapter 2 and 6 and read that for yourself. John might pull it up in a little while, let you read it, but it's there for you to see. All sheep, man's over. All sheep and oxen, yea, the beast of the field, and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passes through the path of the sea. Man was made to have dominion over all this, every bit of it. Glory to God. And Jesus took it back from man. We're going to get into that. Someone says, that's the Old Testament, Hebrews 2. 6 and 9. Hebrews 2, 6 through 9. We blow the fuse. But one in place testified, saying, this is going back to the New Testament point. But one in a certain place testified, saying, what is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visitest him? Thou madest him a little lower than the angels. Thou crownest him with glory and honor and didst set him over the works of thy hand. Now listen, who's created everything? Jesus. He has caused man to be over all his works of thy hand. So his hand, Satan's his creation. I'm telling you, man, you got to quit running. Why do you think he said, resist the devil? In other words, stand against the devil. People like, the devil been on my back all week. Why is your back turned to him? You gonna let him just come in and take over your house? Man, you say, get out in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Don't yell it real loud, your wife will leave. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, so that gets some people mad, won't it? I'm just kidding. Don't be so mad. Y'all so tight. Listen, it says, thou madest him a little lower. Go ahead to verse 8. I got to get done. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet, for in that he put all subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we see not yet all things, but we see Jesus, who was more than the angels, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. For me, for you, a one that knew not what became sin. Think about that. Man, that is powerful. Isaiah 64:8. Isaiah 64:8. If you'll amen me, I'll be getting done. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. You are the potter. We all are the work of your hand. Man, you'd have to go back to Psalms on that. And he said, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Think about that. Fearfully and wonderfully made. He's created you. He's made us like he wants us. You got to learn to love yourself. Other people. In this passage, it is the jest that the great salvation message of Christianity, only God can change the shape of a clay, thereby molding the vessel into the shape and the design that is desired, thereby mending the flaws and the weaknesses. So he takes care of them flaws and them weaknesses. I may not be able to just do away with it right off the bat. I try to work on it, but he takes care of them flaws and them weaknesses. He helps me through them. I don't sit around and wallow in guilt and shame and all that. I pray and I believe God because I'm telling you, as a pastor, and not even before I was a pastor, I've seen people die. But to sit there and watch somebody die, I've seen nurses come in, they'll grab their hands, they'll look at them, and they'll say their eyes are fixed now. As a Christian, your eyes have got to be fixed. And they've got to be fixed on Christ and what he done. And then, as far as your salvation, I'm telling you, that's where you get messed up. Because when you get off that, you start thinking you've done, man, I done gave this money. I've done bought this food. See, I'm using me right now. I done bought this food. I done did this. Man, I'm somebody in the kingdom. I'm somebody in Christ. No, I'm just a servant doing what I've learned to listen to the voice of God. And when God says that, you don't never know what kind of condition somebody's in. So you do that for that purpose. That's the good works that follow. You don't do it for that. It don't get me saved. I'm already saved. The good works follow. But I stay focused and channeled in that my salvation is saved. My good works ain't saving me. If I give something away, it ain't saving me. I'm a fixed man. My eyes are fixed. I'm a dead man. They're fixed on Christ and what he done. So that keeps my salvation set and sealed. And if I ever get off that, if I ever think, man, I'm a pastor. I'm a this and I'm a that and I'm a giver. Man, look who I am. I'm in trouble. Then you get to thinking you're something when you're nothing. Because the only thing we are is what Christ made us. We're the workmanship of Christ. He's the potter. We're the clay. He molds us. Before salvation, I wouldn't give you a dime because I was going to Tunica. Amen? Just being honest. I was going to get high. I was going to get drunk. I didn't care if you got high or drunk. No, I was getting my drunk. If you were there, you could have had it. But that's just the way it was. And then now, what do? He shapes you. It's him that molds you and designs you. Not you. You can't do it. I didn't just wake up one day and say, I'm going to be a good person. It's not in our category. It's not in our, as a whole, we were born. David said, I was conceived in this. We were born. We must be born again. Amen? I'm getting ready to close. Oh, I should have got to take my watch off. Should have got a good amen right there. I'm ready to go home. Glory to God. 1 John 5 and 7. I made it, Brother John. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. And I already got into that in the beginning of service because I know I was going to get there. How are they one? In love and in unity. And how are we in one? In love and in unity. There ain't no way. How are we one? I'm looking at you and you're looking at me. Jesus said we're one. Now, I'm confused as a termite and wooden yo-yo. Someone's going to have to help me. Huh? How are we one? In Christ. And Christ is one with God. Christ is one with us. One in unity and in love. It's the only way we can be one. Because we ain't. I started to come. I knew Travis could handle it. I started to come. That's what I was going to say. But I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. But that's what I was going to do. Does that make us one? No, we're one by unity. And in love. Love in people. Love in Christ. Love in God. Love in the Word of God. We're unity in that. You're talking about people getting healed. You're talking about people getting set free. You know how I got set free? I walked into a church. You know what I told people? And I'll go and say this. I get in trouble. People watch live stream. I said, I got saved during song service. I really did. I think that can happen at this church. I think it has happened. I've seen people get saved during song service. You know what that's called from? It's called from anointing, because the anointing breaks the yokes. Somebody was praying over the services. Someone was believing God. Instead of murmuring, complaining, griping, get somewhere. Every service I get up in my office, I'm not bragging, I get up there and I get on my knees and I pray. And I said, God, don't let it be me. Don't let it be about, but let it be the word of God. Let it touch someone's life. Don't let it just be words. But let it be something that'll transform somebody. It'll change their life forever. But I walked into a service that they've been praying, just like we pray, for people to get saved in the parking lot, people get saved in song service. And bingo, their sucker walked in the door. Man, the power of God was so strong, they were singing, "Draw Me Close to You." And I'm telling you, I don't know how many years it's been since I cried. It was years. I was calloused. I drank, I partied, I did what I wanted to do. I didn't care. Someone died. Didn't matter where they died. It didn't bother me. I was just living my life. I broke and cried. I'll never forget Jacob, 12 years old, sitting at service. And he said, he shared it as a testimony one time. He said, he was sitting there looking. He said, "What did they do to my dad? I've never seen him cry. They done did something to my daddy. What did they do to my daddy?" Man, they sang. I think they preached it. I don't know what happened. I was in that altar crying. I'm telling you, God broke me. A contrite spirit and a broken. He broke me. I cried. They went through the whole service. The service was over with. The preaching was over with. And people were leaving. And there was so much snot and crying and tears. I was sitting there just weeping and crying before God. All that because, see, all my life I had bitterness. I had hatred. I grew up in a city where it was racist. Black man killed my father. I went down with the vice lord, down with the king. I was, if you ain't white, you ain't right. I hate to hurt Jarvis' feelings, but me and Jarvis are like brothers now. If he leaves, I leave with him. But it was the way I raised, it was the way I grew up. And I had that bitterness and hatred. I carried it my whole life. So if I ever see the man that killed my dad, I'll kill him. I carried that with me my whole life, that bitterness. That day, I remember as plain as day. I was laying, I was crying, I was weeping, I was free. I felt like I could jump and touch the ceiling. I turned and looked at someone. I said, "If I could see the man that killed my dad today, I'd like to ask him if he knows Jesus." Something lifted up off me. I said, I would feed him. I would take him and feed him. And be good to him and let him know the same bitterness or hate, whatever, God can set you free. Because he probably lived his whole life with that guilt or that pain too. And that bitterness too. And I thought, he needs to be free too. So my part is free. And I promise you, if I could see him today, I'd feed him. I'd introduce him to Jesus. That's how we're one with God. No other way. That's how you're one with God. You got to love unconditionally. And in closing, John chapter 17, verse 11. "And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world. And I come to thee, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one." What turns people as we are one. Now, how are we going to be one? Now, I'm going to drill that in. We're just not going to get together and be, we're one. One as we're one. And in verse 21, "that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. That the world may believe that thou hast sent me." Boy, can I tell you, when we get in one mind and one accord, if we get to where we walk together in Christ and be a witness to the world and be a light, quit talking about that church or that church or that church, and just say we are the church, every one of us, and walk in unity and the world sees that, then they know you're one with God. They'll want to be a part of the kingdom. Not a church, but a part of the kingdom. Go ahead and close them. "And the glory which thou gavest me, I've given them, that they may be one even as we are one. Now, I'm gonna help you a little bit. What are we? Where's she at? Yeah, but she ain't here. But we're one. There's some people live streaming right now that done shut off. Because that created everything. There is, but he's spirit. You know you can't put God. You can't put God in this body. I can't stand before God. I'd evaporate. But you couldn't stand before him in all his glory and splendor and stand like we are. And that's why you got to have a new body someday. I'll tell you another secret. You wind up in hell, you'll have a glorified body. The glorified want to live forever and burn forever. We don't hear about hell no more, though. I better not get into that. Might lose some of you. I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one. Perfect? What is perfect? Mature. Fully. Amen. There's a lot to that. Glory to God. And that the world may know that thou hast sent me. Love them as thou hast loved me. Man, that's good stuff. Have you ever get to where you love people unconditionally, don't matter who they are? Just love them. Just love them. Don't matter. Amen. You ain't got to live with them. Just love them. Praise God. That's it. Stand to your feet. Play something softly. If you need to pray, come pray. If you, man, just pray where you're at. Pray for Sunday service. Can I tell you something? If you begin to pray for these services, people get saved. People get healed. People get delivered. If you want special prayer, just come.